Welcome back, everyone. Thank you for joining me. Today, I have another wonderful writer of historical fiction, Marina Scott. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you.
She wrote this amazing book called The Hunger Between Us, and we are going to chat all about it and in general about writing, and I just can't wait to get into it. Tell us, Marina, first a little bit about your cultural background and this book. And like, what inspired you to write this book?
Okay. Well, my name is Marina Scott, and I was born and raised in Vilnius, Lithuania, behind the Iron Curtain when Lithuania was part of the Soviet Union. I immigrated to the United States in 2000, and now I live in Salt Lake City, Utah, and work full-time in public finance. The Hunger Between Us is my debut young adult historical fiction novel that is set in 1942 during the siege of Leningrad. And it's a story about the girl's determination to survive while trying to find and rescue her missing friend. And as the search intensifies and the stakes rise, Lisa, that's the name of the main character, she entangles herself in a dangerous web with two former classmates. One of the boys, he lost his home, he lost his family, and now he's forced to live underground. And another boy is a policeman. So the story takes place during summer of 1942, and I wanted to talk about it a little bit, because I chose this time on purpose. The first winter of the siege was really brutal. But the first summer after that winter, it was a bit, life was a bit easier, if you can say that. It was just a bit less brutal comparing to the winter before. So, I wanted my kids to feel the sunshine on their skin and just be outside. But make no mistakes, they still go and experience unimaginable hardships. But I just wanted to be probably just a little less cruel to them. So, and that's why I decided to set that story, my story in the summer.
And did you always have, like, have you always been interested in World War II subjects? Have you written before about this, or is it like, what inspired you to write specifically about this subject?
So yes, I was, there is a reason why I was interested in writing about the siege. And it all goes back to my childhood. As I mentioned before, I was born and raised in Lithuania behind the Iron Curtain in the Soviet Union. And in Soviet schools, the education was controlled by the Soviet government, who determined what we were supposed to learn and what we were not supposed to learn. So in our history lessons, we studied World War II. And the siege of Leningrad was mentioned, but not talked about extensively. Mass starvation was acknowledged, but discussions were mostly centered around the Germans bombing and shelling the city. So the stories about the siege were highly sanitized, which I didn't understand when I was a kid. But the message was like this, fairy tale-like presentation. Under the heroic leadership of the Communist Party, the Soviet people endured and behaved courageously under the ugliest of the circumstances. And that's what I learned as a kid. A story of a great survival under the leadership of the party. So a few years fast forward, and Gorbachev's glasnost opened the door to the influx of information about the real story of the siege and what I learned the end was truly shocking. So the real story of the siege was significantly different from what our Soviet textbooks presented. So during the siege, there was no running water, no electricity, no plumbing. The city was in ruins. Food rations were at starvation levels. A bread ration was 125 grams a day, which roughly translates into 400 calories. So a piece of bread was pretty much this size, and that's all you would get to eat, if you're lucky, because you would still have to have money to buy this tiny piece of bread. So you were expected to be a functional member of the Soviet society who would go to work, make money, buy this piece of bread. And crime was flourishing. There was looting and there was cannibalism. Food distribution system was corrupt and there was massive theft of food and ration cards. And of course, none of this was mentioned in our Soviet textbooks because it just didn't fit the Soviet propaganda image. So I wanted to write a story that would reflect that truth, the truth that was never told in the Soviet textbooks that I studied in school.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it is a brutal time in history, and the people that lived through it are, I mean, heroes in a sense. And you're right, there's, you know, so much information was just not mentioned in the textbooks. I was born in Samara, Russia, Kuzbyshev during the Soviet Union. And so I know all about all the things that, I mean, I was very young when we immigrated to America, but I grew up with a lot of crazy stories. And speaking of even cannibalism, I remember even when in the 80s, I was born in the 80s, and in the 80s, to the extent that my grandmother warned me, she like told me these crazy horror stories, which, you know, in hindsight, I wonder how much of that really should have been told to young children. But I think it's like that Soviet mentality, you scare the loving daylights out of kids so they like listen to you. So my grandma would warn us, like, you know, it was not like normal warning, like, okay, stranger danger, don't go with new people you don't know, because that's like normal. That's a normal warning. But there's also like, I remember we had rumors of like this old lady lured people into her apartment, and in her apartment, she had like a meat grinder and like, oh, a human meat grinder.
Right. And, like, and that's what you were told.
I was told that. I was like under five. I was told like, don't go, people, you could become food.
Well, she really tried to scare you not to go with strangers.
Yeah, but I think my point is, I'm not sure that was happening anymore in the 80s, but my point is, I think those horror stories like persevered throughout the decades, and like, you know, that it was like still in the subconscious of people percolating in the memory and like the hidden depths of the memory of like the horrors that people endured. So I think that it was like a crazy fear. It was like a reality that you know, not only are you worried about the Germans, not only are you worried about like the Soviets and the NKVD, you're also now worried about like not a normal crime, and now you're worried about cannibals. I mean, it's insanity. It's insanity. So have you written before about this topic, or is this your first book venturing into World War II?
So I started seriously writing in 2015, and my first book didn't go anywhere. It took me like 3 years to write it. I did three full rewrites. It was painful, but it was also set. It was in Russia, in Moscow, and I believe it was. Gosh, I don't even remember right now. But it was set in 19. It was right after the war, so it was set in 1948. And it's actually centered mostly around the KGB prison. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I didn't write about specifically World War II. It was right after. Right. So, and then I wrote Hunger in 2019, and it is my second novel. Even though I did queried my first one, and it was surprising how long it took me to write it. And I got quite a few full requests, which was very encouraging, but it didn't go, like I said, it didn't go anywhere. And now looking back, comparing it to Hunger, I see all the mistakes. I do know why it didn't go anywhere. So maybe one day I will rewrite it again.
Yeah.
We'll see. Yeah, you never know.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I hear that all the time. Like, is editing a book worse than just writing a new book? I mean, sometimes it just depends on what mindset you're in, I suppose, you know, like what you feel like doing. But yeah, that's actually really a fast timeline. You wrote it in 2019 and then you're already published in 2022. So that's pretty, I mean, I know 3 years doesn't, maybe for people who are not in the industry, that doesn't seem long, but it's actually quite decent, you know, like that's not years and years of waiting. And
right, so I wrote Hunger through 2019. That took me a year to write it. I started so I revised it because my first drafts are so messy. So I revised it. I sent out the first batch of queries and maybe even a couple batches, and my batches are not like 2-3 queries. They're pretty big because I'm very impatient. So, and I received a revise and resubmit request from actually my current agent. And it was in the beginning of 2020. I started working on my revisions. And then I learned about author mentor match program. Mm-hmm. And I entered and was picked as a mentee. Mm-hmm. So then I worked for 3 months with my mentor again on revising Hunger. So it took a while, and then when we revised, I finally sent it out to the agent who asked for revise and resubmit. And then I waited again, because waiting never ends. It doesn't matter where you are in the process, you're always waiting and waiting on something.
Yeah.
And so it took about 3 months to get an email from her. And she had more revision ideas. So, and at the very end of this of that email was a question, would you like to talk on the phone? Something like that. And I'm like, oh, okay. Yeah, we should probably talk about revisions on the phone. So we scheduled a phone call and we did talk about revisions. Just revisions. And actually, I believed until the very end that the whole phone call was just about revisions, to discuss how we're going to do it. Mm-hmm. And then at the very end, I got an offer of representation, which was kind of shocking and thrilling at the same time, because I did not expect that. It was like a total surprise, a very nice surprise. But yeah, that was my call. And then, you know, the usual, like I went back, notified other agents about it, about an offer, and waited about 2 weeks and then signed with my current agent. Yeah. So it was all 2019 writing, almost the whole year of 2020 revising, going back and forth with revisions. And then we revised some more and we went on submission in the beginning of 2021. So from the very start, when I wrote that first sentence, I dig my mama's grave at dawn, to the very last revision when we send it out, it was almost two full years.
Wow. I'm wondering, if it's not too personal, can you give me us a brief outline of what she wanted you to revise, in terms of like, was it a POV thing? Was it, was it like actual timeline of the story? Like what exact, I'm just so curious, because clearly it worked, you know, she signed you. So I'm just curious, you know, it might be helpful for some other writers to hear like the things that she wanted you to change.
Yes. So, and you read the book. Before I go into what we revised, I'm going to ask you a question. So did you think it was too dark, too sad? Like,
well, okay, that's a good question. I thought, I mean, given the subject matter, I knew it was going to be sad. I knew it was going to be incredibly sad. And also, have you heard of the book, or maybe you've read the book because it's similar in nature, City of Thieves?
Yes.
Yeah. I've read. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So it kind of reminded me in part of that, because the characters are totally different. It's about, you know, two guys versus two girls and all that's different, but the setting is the same. So I knew in terms of subject matter, what to kind of expect, except that one was a little more, there was a little more comedic kind of comedic note to it. So I thought it was pretty dark, but given the subject matter, I mean, I read Solzhenitsyn, so I don't, you know what I mean? Like, I can't say, I didn't expect it to be anything other than dark. But I was wondering, like, the ending, and spoiler alert. So guys, sorry if you guys haven't read it yet, but, I was curious that I was going to ask you about the ending. You know, in the original ending, was she, because I for a second thought she was going to die, you know, and that was going to be the end. And I was like, holy smokes, this is a sad end. Like, everyone's just dead. But I'm glad you gave us a little bit of hope that she survived, even though it's like under really sad circumstance. Yeah, I was wondering how much of that was revised or how much of that was the original ending.
It was not the original ending. So the ending we revised so many times. Yeah. You know, it's hard. I think one of the most difficult parts for me is writing the ending, because the ending needs to feel satisfying, that the story arc is complete, characters arc complete. So the very last, I will tell you this. So we rewrote it so many times because we tried to find that arc that would be complete and satisfying. However, that being said, the very last scene in the cemetery, it remained the same through all revisions but one, now I'm remembering. So what we revised in general, the core of the story, we never changed that. Lisa's POV always remained just hers. The whole storyline, the timeline, the structure remained the same. There were a few scenes that were completely changed. And well, one of the reasons, my first few drafts, if you think the book is dark, the first few drafts were way darker. And it was a young adult novel, and Melissa, my agent, and she's like, no, we need to soften, you know, something.
Soften the blow somewhere.
What needs to be softened, I don't want to give any spoilers. So we kind of rewrote a few things. And so it's mostly towards the end that was a complete rewrite. There were some scenes in the beginning, but it was pretty much the second half of the book when they go back to the mansion. So the heist wasn't in the original draft. It wasn't there. The fire was. The fire stayed pretty much through all revisions. The storyline, the father's storyline stayed the same. Lisa's storyline also stayed the same, but it was a little darker, so we had to soften it a little bit. There was one scene that was really, really dark. Mm-hmm. And in fact, we kind of kept it there, but then at the very beginning, during submission process, we started getting rejections, and some of them were pointing out, not directly, but mentioning that it's too dark, too stomach turning. And we're like, okay, we know exactly which part it is. So I don't
know. Did it involve cannibals?
Yes. yes. So yeah. we had to rewrite. I had to rewrite a few scenes. But so there was one revision where Lisa actually died. And then that didn't work for the story. So, and then I revised again. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, actually that fire, the mansion, the ending, the mansion part, you know, it was kind of a difficult time to, it was really sad to read because it was just like one death after the next. And you just keep finding out dead. And it was a lot, but I mean, that's kind of, I mean, at the very least, it's very realistic. You know, I mean, it was a very much a time when so many people just died. Like it's astounding how people can live through that, you know, and come out and then continue to live lives and not completely crumble under the grief and sorrow of losing most of the people that they knew, and under such circumstance. So I think, you know, I don't know what else to, like, it is what it is. It's that kind of time period and that kind of situation. So, I actually was going to say what I really liked too about this book is, I enjoyed the twist of the little love interest twist, you know, the two boys, and one of them seemed good in the beginning. One of them said, again, guys, sorry, spoiler alert. I hope, maybe read the book and come back to this interview. but I was just, I enjoy it when it's not like quite sure, like you don't really know who the person's going to end up with because you don't know who is like actually the intentions, like who's the good guy, who's the bad guy. And the thing is, nobody's really the good, there's no like complete hero here. They're all a little gray, given the circumstance, that's understandable. But I liked that there was a little twist where the person that you thought she might end up with is not really the case, you know? So I thought that was, I liked that a lot because that's not very predictable. And it kind of reminded me the whole like Mr. Darcy and Pride and Prejudice a little bit, like Mr. Wickham looks like a good guy in the beginning, but then turns out the other way. So I enjoy that kind of flip. So was that also a revision or was that like the original plan?
That was the original plan from the very beginning. I knew, so as a writer, I love writing about morally gray characters because I find them always fascinating. They keep me on my toes and something that I enjoy. Because I know if I write something about who's good through and through, I'll just get bored. Because for me personally, it's like, well, okay, well, and what happens? You know, I want something unexpected, to find out something unexpected in my character. And I know it's usually, when I say unexpected, it's not gonna be that great. So Luca it was from the very beginning, in my mind, there will be a twist with him. I didn't know what kind of twist until I started writing, because I don't outline. I just kind of spill it all out on my paper. So I'm shooting from the hip. And then when we got to a certain scene, oh, I knew exactly what's he gonna do and why and what and where the relationship is gonna go from there. And the same with Maxim. I really enjoy his character because with Maxim, you really never know what's he gonna do next. Yeah. And it's like he has power. And is he gonna use it for something good or he's gonna use it for something bad? And I wanted a reader to keep guessing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I really enjoyed that. That came through really, really well. And so that was, you know, to be honest, and that I'm glad you had a little of that like love motif going because it kind of kept it lighter and it kind of gave it a little hope and definitely gave it hope in the end. So I think that was, and it took some of the attention away from like the darkness. So I think that that was a good call. That was a really good call.
So when I was writing and when Lisa was with Luca in the tunnels, And the kissing scene wasn't there at first. So mm-hmm. I wrote the whole, in my first draft, I wrote through her time being in the tunnels. And then I'm kind of like, I remember I was driving to work in the morning and I'm like, I don't like it. It feels rushed. And why does it feel to me that it's not complete? So I started thinking about it and I'm like, oh, I know, because I didn't give my kids any light moments in the tunnels. Mm-hmm. So I went back and I added that scene when Luca takes her to see unfinished metro platform. I had to go back and I added it. Mm-hmm. Because it felt right. Mm-hmm. Like they need to have that moment, romantic moment, mm-hmm. just to ease up tension a little bit, because I knew really bad things are going to happen after that. So I wanted to give them something, you know, a little bit of sunshine.
Yeah. No, that was a really good call. And it also heightened, it gave us a break from a lot of the, like I said, the darkness, and it heightened the tension between them, which is always great. We know tension is great for novels. So that was really fun. Despite the fact that this was, I was telling you, you know, despite the fact that this is a dark novel, I enjoyed it on my vacation. So.
Well, I'm glad to hear it. It makes me happy. Because it is a dark story. And the kids, they lived through so much. The first winter, they've seen, they lost their friends, their family, their homes. So it changes. Experience like this changes you, especially when you're at such a young age. So it's, like I said, my first draft was really dark. So that's why we need agents who can guide us to say, well, no, you're writing for the kids. Maybe you should soften it.
Yeah. Do you have any family that fought in World War II?
Well, yes, my grandmother, she was born in Lithuania. She lived through World War II in Lithuania. Yeah. Mm-hmm. She passed away now, but mm-hmm. she did live.
Yeah. I mean, it's most people from the Soviet Union have like really sad kind of insane stories. I have a great uncle that died on every side, with the exception of my mom's father, who actually himself fought in World War II and was a commander of tanks at 17. And he had two brothers who also fought in the war, and they all came back from the war, which is really unheard of, the fact that all three fought and all three came back. And there's just, yeah, there's a lot of really crazy stories and very sad stories. So, there's like villages that my grandparents, like cousins and their relatives, they lived in these like little villages in near Samara. And if you go to those villages to this day, they have those obelisks where they have the last names of the people who died. And it's all like my relatives' last names. It's just like list after list after list. It's just a lot of people lost, just families, just like groups of families died. And so knowing that, I think, I mean, maybe other people might not know, but I think knowing that, yeah, it's not surprising that you had in the end, in that mansion and that fire scene, just like name after name, just like gone, gone, gone. So yeah, it's a really intense time in history that I hope we don't repeat as a human race, but I don't know. Well, I don't know.
Yeah, we don't know. I think we're at the point where we really don't want to know, because history tends to repeat itself, unfortunately.
Yeah, people seem to not like to learn. Well, I think there are people who tend to learn from history, and they try really hard to warn people who could be bent on not learning. So it's a very strange time we're living through, and I hope we don't repeat it. But let's not go down that path, because that's another dark That's another dark wormhole. What I wanted to see if we already talked a lot about how long it took you to query and what your process was like in general. Do you have any like insight to, now that you're, you know, published, do you have an insight to like the industry in general? And have you seen any particular genres that are being kind of requested by agents and editors?
Well, that's a tricky question, because it's really very hard to say what's, you know, what's trending, because what is trending today might not be trending in 3 months or even in 2 weeks. So in young adult field, I think contemporary romance is going strong, and thrillers. Adult thrillers are still going strong as well. Romance was always popular in adult area. I'm not sure if it's, I'm not watching romance because I don't read romance, but I think it's still popular. So back to young adult, fantasy is going strong, retellings. And I think in, but don't take my word, like, don't quote me anywhere, because it's just me talking out loud. It's my thoughts. So I do hope historical fiction is on the at least in top four, maybe five, because history has so much to offer as far as stories and lessons, and so it's always will be interesting, I think, to read. And so I talked to a bookseller a few weeks ago, and I asked her about young adult, what are the most like sellable genres. She did mention pretty much everything I just mentioned, but historical fiction was number three on her list. And I said, wow, that is very interesting. Actually, it was ahead of fantasy, which I was shocked, because it seems everywhere you look, it's fantasy, right? Or thrillers or contemporary romance. So, and she said something that stuck with me. She said, historical fiction gives you an escape. It's almost like fantasy, but it's based on real facts. So it provides, I don't remember exactly how she said, but she said it provides a certain escapism, but it also it gives you an opportunity to learn something about the past.
Yeah.
So that was very encouraging.
That is interesting. Did she say what particular time period that's really in demand? Or
No, I don't think I took it that far, but I assume 20th century, it will always be in demand. World War II, maybe World War I. By the way, I do see vampires, or at least I heard vampires are coming back. I'm like, wow, no. Oh, you never know.
Well, someone needs to write a book about World War II and vampires, and then we'll be like, we'll complete.
There you go. Let's change some trend at least.
I actually think there's like a Russian show that came out maybe last year, and it was about vampires in during the Revolutionary War, and it was like a retelling of the Russian Revolution through this like fantasy lens of like vampires being involved somehow, which I thought was an interesting take.
It is. I'd watch that. I don't mind watching vampires. I'd never write one, but
no, I know exactly. I don't mind watching it, but yeah, I don't think I'm into the whole vampire writing. Well, okay. So what about writing right now? Are you writing anything? Are you working on a new project?
It takes me a long time to settle on a project. Like I'm meandering between projects. So I have a few ideas right now that I am researching, but nothing is set in stone. I'll just keep researching and see what sticks. So
are you going to stick to YA historical fiction or something new?
It is historical, is at YA. I have two projects. One is YA, one is more adult, but can go YA as well. So like I said, it's all over the place.
And historical, also 20th century.
Yes, yes. So one is 1903, and one, the other one that I was looking was, has two timelines back to the World War II, 1942 and 1945. Mm. So we'll see.
1903, is it set also in the Soviet Union, or is it?
No, this one is set actually in Chicago.
Oh, Chicago, okay. Cool, yeah. The Soviet Union is a fascinating subject. I think it's still very fresh. You know, clearly we were born in the Soviet Union, and yet it's distant enough to feel like a little bit like a hazy dream, and like, I can't believe that all happened. So it's like really crazy to explore the topics and the subjects and so much. Have you ever considered writing a book set in Lithuania? I think that would be really interesting.
Yes, potentially yes, but there are a lot of stories I can tell. I just need to pick one, right? And it's very difficult.
I know. I know, the sticking to the stories. I have 1,000 ideas until I finally start. And sometimes I'll write a chapter and I'm like, new idea.
I notice with myself, it's not just one chapter. I need to write about 50, 70 pages.
Oh.
And then I'm like, no, not interested. And people were like, but you already have 70 pages. I'm like, yeah, I don't care. It's done.
Well, I mean, because you're a pantser, right? You don't really plot. So I think that makes sense, because you got to get into the headspace of these writers and kind of understand, and then you'll begin to see where the plot is going.
Right. I did try to outline once, and I wrote outline. It was like 3 pages outline, and it all sounded great. And then I started writing and I just threw it away, because it was like, no, this is not right. So I'm like, why am I trying to force myself to outline when I don't like outlines? And for me, writing is really a very creative process. Like, I don't even know my characters. So I am just enjoying, it's like unwrapping a gift at Christmas, all the layers, and you don't know what you're gonna find. Like with Luca, I was unwrapping and then I didn't know what the twist is gonna be. I knew he will do something. I just didn't know what it was until I got to that scene and the last layer, you know, and I'm like, oh, of course. I know exactly what's gonna happen. Well, yes. And why he's gonna do it. Of course, it makes all sense. It all kind of came together.
Together
like a puzzle. Yeah.
I love those moments where you're like, ah, beautiful epiphany, just like blooms in front of you and everything falls into place. I like to pant. I'm a pantser too. I do have like, sometimes I'll have like a very rough draft of like just like 5 bullet points, because I know like where the, I just need to, I know that I need to get here, but I don't know anything in between. And sometimes those bullet points change too as I write. So maybe like only 2 or 3 of them remain the same from like my rough draft. But I agree. I feel like I love the creativity of writing. And so when you kind of, I think outlines could be a little deceptive, because they make it look like you've got everything together and you have like, you've plotted all this stuff, but there's still gotta be chemistry. It's kind of like dating on paper versus meeting in person.
Yeah.
Where like on paper it could look good, but then you meet in person, there's no chemistry. And so it's kind of like that to me personally. So I feel like it's deceptive. Like, yeah, it could all look good on paper, and you start writing it and you don't like the characters, you don't like where it's going, it feels robotic. So
yes, exactly, that's how I felt with my outline, and felt robotic, and I'm like, I don't like this feeling, that's not me. So yeah, that's why I tossed it, started writing from scratch.
Do you write in like Lithuanian or Russian?
No. Oh my gosh. I was like, but well, I've been in this country for 22 years now. Even when I speak to my mom in Russian, and all my friends, I speak in Lithuanian. mm-hmm. from even here in the United States. So, but yeah, I insert English words all the time. With my mom does the same. With my friends, we speak Lithuanian, then we start inserting English phrases. I can't even type in Russian. I would not be, I would be like, it's no.
Yeah, I have like-
And my, the sentences probably would be awful. The structure and grammar, it's like, it's embarrassing to admit, but no.
Yeah.
I can talk in Russian and Lithuanian, don't ask me to write.
Yeah, I'm the same. Like I have even the keyboard that I have that's in my in Russian is the phonetic one. It's not like the legit Russian keyboard because otherwise it'll take me forever to find the letters because I don't know that keyboard. But yeah, it's kind of sad. I can translate from Russian to English, but to write in Russian creatively is very difficult.
Right.
When I was younger, because I write poetry, when I was younger and I was a lot more immersed in the language because I grew up in this like super Russian community, I wrote a couple of really bad poems in Russian. And I think ever since then, I was like, no, this is clearly not happening.
Right. Well, I don't think I ever wrote, well, bad poem long time ago. I remember writing something in Russian. Some stories, I think it was about a dog. I was like 10 years old. In Lithuanian, yes, I did write and actually submitted to a magazine a very long time ago, an article. Yeah, but that was it. And then I just moved to the United States and I had other problems. I had to learn the language, you know, go to school, all of that. So yeah, like I said, I didn't write seriously until 2015. Mm-hmm.
What called you to it? Is just like a passion that you've like kind of put on the back burner, or was it a new discovery you made about yourself to write something?
I always wanted to write. Like even back home, I always felt this need to write something creative, you know, tell stories. But like I said, when I moved to the United States, there's like my plate was overflowing with so much. And I went to the university here in Utah and I started accounting. So that pretty much took all my time, tried to figure it out. And then when I settled, I think with my career, with my life, so it took me 15 years. That need of for a creative outlet came back. And that's when I'm like, okay, let me try again. And I tried, and like I said, it took me 3 years. I was learning because I never took any creative English classes. Mm-hmm. It was painful. It was really painful, but I was stubborn and determined. I'm like, I'm gonna finish this book no matter how long it takes, and I'm gonna learn. So
wonderful. Well, and it paid off because just like, you know, second book, that's really great. It was just your second book and it got published. So that's really, that's really wonderful.
Sometimes I can't even believe it. It's still so surreal that it is actually happening.
Yeah. Well, congratulations. It is.
Thank you.
Do you have any advice for writers trying to make it in the industry?
Oh, well, I'm sure people before me here gave plenty of very good advice. So I will share not an advice, I will share a lesson I learned.
Okay.
So, you know, we people usually by nature, we tend to look forward all the time, ahead, into the future. What's next? Like we accomplish one project, we write one book, and then we just look forward into the future. What's next? Let's write another one. Let's find an agent. Let's send out 10 queries or 15, whatever you think is appropriate. You know, you get the book deal. Okay, what's next? I need to write something else. So it's always looking into the future. What I learned about myself, what helps me mentally, because like I said, this industry is not predictable. You cannot foresee the next step because even when you think you know what's gonna happen, you might be surprised. It goes completely different direction. So what I learned is just to slow down, to stop and maybe give yourself a break from looking into the future and asking yourself what's next. Instead, just focus on your present and look back. Look at what you accomplished so far and just feel grateful for that. And it doesn't have to be a big thing. It doesn't have to be a book. It can be just like one chapter. I work full time. So sometimes I come home exhausted and all I can write is just like one page. And it's probably a pretty bad, messy page that will be tossed. But just like, I learned to feel grateful even for that one page. Mm-hmm. So, and I know it's easier said than done, just because by nature we are driven to achieve, especially in this culture, it's all about achievement, to do more. It's really changed my perspective a little bit, and it's hard. I've had to force myself and say, hey, don't worry about what's next. What next book are gonna write? Don't worry about it. Just enjoy this ride. Just like look at yourself. You know, you accomplished so much. Be grateful. So that's a lesson I learned. Just slow down, be in the present, and be grateful.
Spoken like a true sage. I think that be present is so important. You're right. And the other thing is, I think you're right. Like no matter what step you're in this process, you're always waiting and things can all like you're always waiting for something new to like make you feel more accomplished. Like if before you have an agent, it's getting an agent. When you get an agent, it's finding an editor and publishing house. Then it's the revisions, then it's the sales, then it's the competition, then it's more sales, then it's the next book. How's it going to do? And it's just like nonstop. The grind is nonstop.
It is nonstop. Yeah.
And I've spoken to, and that's something that I'm really like, that is the biggest lesson that is great. I'm so grateful for it during these interviews when I talk to people to learn how much it's so important to stay in the present because it never ends. That grind doesn't really end while you're in this industry.
Yes, it applies to any industry.
Any creative industry, particularly. Right. Yeah.
Because I keep noticing, I'm catching myself thinking, okay, well, my book is coming out on November 1st. Is it going to sell? How many copies? And I'm like, why? I'm worried about things I cannot control.
Yeah.
Like focus on what I have right now and what I'm accomplishing and doing what I have. Like, you know, don't worry if it's going to sell or not, if people are going to like it or not. You just, you know, forget that. It's very difficult actually to do, but I'm trying.
It is. It's always difficult to stay in the present. I think that's why so many philosophies preach it, to like remain in the present, be grateful, remain in the present, be grateful. It's really the only way to make it through life. to not get carried away with the project.
And a few years ago, it was pre-pandemic, we went on a trip to Thailand and I spoke to a Buddhist monk and it was pretty much the same. Stay in the present, you know, be grateful. And I listened and I'm like, that's great, you know, it's that's great. And then I come back and you get into your routine and you work and you write and then you try to get an agent and you forget that. Until you do get an agent and you do get a book deal and you suddenly realize you can't be always like really like running and thinking about what's next, because it's going to eventually like, you know, destroy your creativity. So I keep remembering now about that monk who said like, you know, be present, enjoy the moment, you know, and I'm like, well, I should have listened more. Back then, a few years ago, what else was he saying?
It's so funny, like you have to go all the like halfway across the world to hear a message that you could read in almost like any philosophical like self-help thing, and you still like that's how difficult it is, because that's when it really sticks. Like some learned man from afar tells you these.
I know it sounds so exotic. Marina went to Thailand, listened to the monk, but the moral of the story is I did not listen to him until years and years later.
Sometimes those are the best lessons, when you don't listen and you have to learn the hard way, you know?
Yeah.
It really sticks.
That is true. That is so true.
Okay, well, any parting words? Why don't you tell us where to follow you on Twitter? And I know your Twitter and IG and maybe something else, and when your book is coming out and where to buy it.
Okay, so The Hunger Between Us is coming out November 1st. It will be available everywhere where books are sold, online, bookstores. Just Google it, find your store. Hopefully you will guys support whoever is listening, your local indie store, and hopefully you can order it there. And what else did you say, parting words?
Where to follow you.
Okay, so I am on two platforms, Twitter. My name on Twitter is Nimka SLC. And I am on IG as well, Instagram. I like Instagram a little bit better than Twitter. Hopefully it's nothing personal to anyone. And it's Marina V. Scott on Instagram.
Scott. Okay. Perfect. We can get all that information in the description of this video so that people, you know, can just click and find you. Thank you so much. This has been
You for having me. That was fun.
Absolutely. I mean, you wrote an amazing book. You should be very proud of yourself and grateful, like we just talked. And yeah. And I think definitely people, it's such an important piece of history to read and remind ourselves. It might be dark, but it's important. It's better to read about these dark times in a book than make the same mistakes and learn them in real life. So
I agree. That's true.
Yeah. So thank you so much for coming. And whenever you finish your next book, it'd be great to have you back on and chat about that. Thank you everybody for listening, and we'll see you next time. Please, oh wait, before I completely log off, like, share, and subscribe. I always forget to say that in the beginning. I got to learn that. But anyways, thanks you guys for watching and listening, and we'll see you guys next time. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.